Hey guys, what's going on? James here, and in today's video I just wanted to give you a little bit of a training camp, not a refresher, but like a little bit of a training camp info video, I guess if you could say. I'm going to be breaking down players and storylines that you need to watch out for, what days you can go to training camps or otherwise which days will be open up to the public, and what I will personally be doing on the channel for training camp. This is I'll just be talking about that a little bit. There will be a separate video going up today as well with my official announcement of what dates I'm going to, what I'm going to be doing specifically on the channel, both in video format and in live streaming format, and stuff like that. So there's going to be a lot of stuff coming to the channel, so I hope you all enjoy. So let's officially get started with players and storylines to watch out for. So at the recording of this video, so I'm recording this at 4:14 a.m. July 27th, which is the second official day of Buccaneers training camp. Obviously, practice has not started yet, considering it's 4 in the morning, but by the time I'm sure a lot of you wake up, the second day of practice will officially be done. So we have one day of training camp practice to talk about here. So let's talk about the first training camp day. So some things that I've heard of that I've liked, and keep in mind, I wasn't personally there at the training camp, so a lot of this is thanks to the guys of Greg Allman, who did a lot of interviewing, Pewter Report, among other people. So this is kind of those are my two main sources for usual things, are Greg Allman and the Pewter Report. So if you need any other further information about any of these things, definitely go check them out. They are two incredibly knowledgeable sources for Buccaneers news related content. I mean, it is their job, so I mean, what do you expect? But anyway, talking about some stuff that I saw just from overall videos and things that I've heard. I heard things like Freddie Martino had a good time, had a good first practice. There was a lot of talk about the whole Jameis Winston suspension thing, which is expected. As it stands right now, Dirk Cutter is looking to he's focusing on getting Ryan Fitzpatrick prepared for week one. And right now the general feel is that everybody's ready to move past this whole Jameis Winston suspension thing. So let's dive right into all of it. So the first thing that I wanted to talk about is players that could have possibly impressed with the first day of practice. So, and the storylines that this could be proceeding moving forward. So, some players that did impress were guys like Freddie Martino. MJ Stewart apparently had a very good day, if not the best day for a cornerback, the best day for an entire defender, which I feel is very impressive. And then a couple other guys had some nice days as well. I think Bobo Wilson had a pretty decent day. I think Peyton Barber had a decent day as well, as among a couple of others. Some interesting things to note is the starting offense and the starting defense. So the starting offense goes as follows. It goes Donovan Smith at left tackle, Ali Marpet at right guard, Ryan Jensen at center, Caleb Benenock at right guard, and DeMar Dotson at right tackle, with wide receivers DeSean Jackson, Chris Godwin, Mike Evans, Peyton Barber at running back. Ryan Fitzpatrick had sole possession of the first team lineup, so which I think is very interesting, and obviously Cameron Brate and OJ Howard. So all this is basically how we expected. What I thought was kind of interesting to note was that Ryan Fitzpatrick had sole possession of the first team. You know, I thought you would see a little bit of Jameis Winston. However, Jameis Winston was working a lot with the twos. So some backup guys like Leonard Wester. Actually, DeMar Dotson didn't practice a whole lot, considering he's still a little bit injured. They're still trying to get him back into the swing of things. So Leonard Wester was rotating in a little bit in terms of the ones. But backup lineman Alex Kappel was there. Evan Smith was there as well. Wester, like I said, among some other guys. Ronald Jones got some stuff in. Ryan Griffin was the main, or no, Jameis Winston was the second quarterback working with the twos. So really just kind of what you expect, right? It is very interesting that they are running Jameis Winston with the twos. I think that's necessary because you don't want Jameis Winston to just flat out not practice a whole lot in terms of like whole team practices. You still got to make sure he isn't rusty or anything. So this makes sense to me, right? This is all we were kind of predicting. And even looking at the defense, your first team defense was Levante David, Quan Alexander, Adarius Taylor at linebacker. The reason Adarius Taylor is over at what is usually Kendall Beckwith's spot is because Kendall Beckwith is still hurt. And your starting defensive line was Jason Pierre-Paul, Bo Allen, Gerald McCoy, and Vinny Curry. So again, exactly what we expected. Your starting safeties were Justin Evans and Chris Conte. Your starting cornerbacks were Brent Grimes and Vernon Hargraves. So again, pretty much all of this is exactly what we expected it to be, at least to start. Again, no starting rookies on either side of the ball. That's expected. Maybe give it a week or two, and maybe some of these guys might work their way into the starting lineups. However, I feel that's probably unlikely because the Bucs usually don't move them in with the ones very often. If they do, we'll probably see it sprinkled in a little bit, but I don't expect many, if any, of these rookies to work with the ones. Another interesting fact was Jack Citchie was actually with the third team linebackers. Basically, he wasn't with the twos. The second string linebacking core consisted of guys like Devontae Bond, Riley Bullough, and then Cameron Lynch, which I think is fair. Again, it's still that thing of these rookies are going to be at the bottom of the depth chart. You know, they're going to be right at the bottom, and they're just going to have to build their way up to getting prominent roles on the team. So I would take none of that super seriously. It's not like it's like, oh, the coaching staff doesn't approve of Vita Vea. No, they don't like Jack Citchie that much. And, you know, it's nothing like that. It's just what they usually do every year. I think it's a little bit silly, but I guess I can understand why. You kind of just want to get them acclimated by running with the, you know, it makes sense because they don't know the system. So you kind of have to build them towards it. You have to build them up the ladder, and eventually they'll get to where they're going to be for the rest of the season, which is probably backup roles and either that or like fringe starting roles. So again, it happened with guys like Chris Godwin, it happened with some of these other guys, and it'll happen to these guys as well. Another interesting thing that I also thought was this cornerback battle that I think is going to be pretty interesting. So as it stands right now, Carlton Davis is the backup number two. So what that means is whenever Vernon Hargraves has to move inside, Ryan Smith comes out as the second cornerback, like what we all thought. MJ Stewart is the backup nickel corner. So if Hargraves can't go, MJ Stewart will come in. That might change considering how things go. It's a really weird dynamic. The Buccaneers have a cornerback right now. They might like Hargraves so much on the outside that they'll run nickel with Hargraves on the outside and then just have MJ Stewart come out. You know, just have the three best cornerbacks that they have out. That could very well be a situation that occurs. I'm very interested to see that moving forward. Another thing I'm very interested to see is how the backup linebacker situation comes up with Jack Citchie. I definitely want to see him and Adarius Taylor win these starting backup spots, and it sounded like they both had a pretty good first day of camp, first day of practice. I haven't, obviously, when this goes up at around 4 or 4:30, the second day will be done as well, so I'm sure you guys will probably have read all about that. I'm sure I'll be posting a live stream talking about the second day of training camp as well. And then I'm also interested to see guys like Bobo Wilson, Freddie Martino, who both apparently, at least from what I saw, they both had some pretty decent plays towards the end of practice. I'm interested to see that as well. One thing I hope stops after the first day. I hope it stops after the first day. So the reporters asked a lot of questions about the Jameis Winston suspension, and I totally understand that. I get that. It makes sense. It happened. It's a hot topic thing. It's something that'll generate buzz, you know. I understand that. But I hope this is a situation that ends after day one. Because honestly, if you're asking these guys the same questions every day for the next like week, I imagine that gets kind of old. I mean, it would get old to me. So they asked Dirk Cutter plenty of questions about the whole Jameis Winston situation. I counted. I think they asked Dirk Cutter 23 questions, right? And I'm pretty sure around 16 or 17 of those questions, I know for they asked him around 23 questions, and 70% of those questions were about Jameis Winston's suspension. And that's me like taking out the couple that were about Ryan Fitzpatrick. So I mean, if you want to, you know, count those, then pretty much every question was about the Jameis Winston suspension. And obviously, same with Jameis Winston. They asked Bucs teammates. They asked everybody. I hope this is a situation that ends after the first day of training camp, because I would get pretty sick of that pretty quickly, if I'm being honest. So that was another interesting thing to note. Greg Allman had many quotes for Dirk Cutter and what he was saying about this these situations. He said that they're moving on with Ryan Fitzpatrick. They're pretty much done with this. It's a distraction. They don't want to deal with you know, they're done dealing with it. A little bit of an interesting question was, you know, is Jameis Winston going to be the guy week four? And Dirk Cutter said, we'll think about that at week four. Now, I want you guys to take that answer with a grain of salt. I don't think that's Dirk Cutter saying Jameis Winston isn't going to be our starting quarterback for week four. That's Dirk Cutter saying that's a stupid question to ask right now, because that's like 2 months away. And it's a deflection answer, okay? That to me is a deflection answer, okay? That's exactly what I would take it as. It's just kind of like, okay, whatever, next question type of answer. I wouldn't take that as an answer of saying they genuinely don't believe in Jameis. Jameis Winston even came out in his own interview with reporters this first day of practice and said, everybody has shown support of me from the ownership all the way to the bottom of the organization. The entire organization has supported Jameis Winston. He said it himself. So it's not a situation like they're losing faith in Jameis Winston. Everybody's been in support of Jameis Winston. So yeah, don't, if you read that quote so far, I'm here to tell you that it's okay. It's nothing to like freak out about. I don't personally think it is. I hope you guys don't freak out about it. I'm not going to. And then they did interview Jameis Winston a little bit. And one interesting question I thought, this is a really ballsy question, was they asked Jameis Winston if he should be cut. It was either if he should be cut or if he's worried about being cut or something like that. And Jesus, I want to meet the reporter who asked that question, by the way. But Jameis Winston's answer was basically saying, you know, like, I've done a lot for this community. I have to regain their trust. I basically said no. He basically just said no, to give the short answer. But I feel that during Jameis Winston's interview, he was very remorseful. He said he's apologized to basically everybody in the organization, it seems. I'm sure he even apologized to the janitors at some point. He seems very remorseful. He is trying to better himself. Obviously, that was a couple of years ago, and it's unfortunate that a very dumb mistake that he made and a very poor mistake that he made affects the team 2 years later, but that's just the way things in the NFL work sometimes. And Jameis Winston came off as very genuine, very remorseful, and I'm willing to accept that he is moving towards a change. And I'm definitely looking forward to seeing him play in week four and beyond for the rest of the season. So now moving forward into these next few days of training camp, practice number two is done by the upload of this video. Moving forward, we're going to be seeing a lot more of Ryan Fitzpatrick. We're going to be seeing a lot more of guys, you know, small, like guys who are roster fringe type of guys. You know, we'll be hearing a lot about Vita Vea. We'll be hearing a lot of like newcomers like Jason Pierre-Paul, Vinnie Curry, Bo Allen, Mitch Unrein. We'll be hearing a lot about the backup linebackers, the backup wide receivers. We'll be hearing a lot about Ronald Jones, Rojo, as the kids call him. Peyton Barber will be hearing a lot about. Those are just kind of guys to keep your eyes and ears on coming up here in the next few days of training camp. Not only if you are going to these training camps, but also if you're looking up updates on these training camps, maybe you're looking to my channel, maybe you're looking at Twitter. These are names that are definitely going to be mentioned throughout the course of the preseason practices, all of this stuff. You know, pay attention to the rookies. You know, guys like Jack Sitchi, he's going to be a big guy. Former rookies like Stevie Tuikulavatu, who's might be a roster fringe guy. You know, there's a lot. There's going to be a lot to keep track of, and it should be pretty fun. So, yeah, guys, that's pretty much it for this kind of little training camp update video. Pay attention to guys like Ronald Jones, Peyton Barber, Bobo Wilson, Freddie Martino. And pay attention to the interviews. The interviews are one of the big things for me to pay attention to, because that's how you kind of get most of this information. That's kind of how you get most of the substance of what has happened at these practices. If it's straight out of Cutter's mouth, if it's straight out of Winston's mouth, you know, whoever says it, you know, I like to think that there is some, I know a lot of it's kind of like media deflection-y type answers, but I like to think that some of it is like genuine. Not some of it. I think a lot of it is genuine, them giving what they feel is a their personal answer to a question. So definitely pay attention to all of that. Again, I'll be coming out with an announcement video, like probably, like honestly, very shortly after this video comes out. So watch out for that. It'll be explaining all the stuff that I'm going to be talking about during this training camp. You know, and the content that's going to be coming out during these training camps, during the preseason games. We're back in the busy season. For me personally, it's going to be a lot. So I'm excited. I hope you guys are excited too. There's going to be a lot more content coming to this channel. I know I've been really consistent with stuff lately in terms of uploading. I always upload a lot. You know, it is what it is. But there's going to be even more. So I'm excited. I hope you guys are excited too. And yeah, watch out for the announcement video very soon. So yeah, hope you guys all enjoyed this video. And as always, I will see you in the next video or live stream. But until then, goodbye for now, guys. And as always, go Bucs!